Hollywood Awards season up and running, a Filipino chef leads a team that brings delectable dishes to a star-studded clientele. Our Hollywood correspondent Yong Chavez talks to Chef John Umali about his journey from a small Filipino restaurant in California to one of LA's most iconic hotels.
Behind this delectable dishes at one of the most historic hotels in Los Angeles is Filipino executive chef John Umali. The Biltmore is a 100-year-old icon of old Hollywood glamour and a venue for some of the biggest Los Angeles events, including award season ceremonies. It was the home of the Academy Awards during its early years. Chef John oversees around 150 employees, from cooks to servers to kitchen backup workers to cleaners. It's a job far from his humble beginnings when he was a new U.S. immigrant in the late 2000s.
Nag-umpisa ka sa mga Filipino restaurant.
Yes. Shout out to Tita Cela Restaurant in Carson. Doon ako nag-start. I didn't go to school culinary. I started from the bottom. Prior going here sa US, sa Philippines, I didn't even cook. I worked my way up. 16 years after, I'm here at the Biltmore and representing.
The 40-year-old chef recalls how he fell in love with making food.
Paano ka nagkaroon ng interest sa pagluluto?
I couldn't find a job. I have a bachelor's degree in IT actually, pero hindi ako makakuha ng work. I had to find a job, and nung pumasok sa Filipino restaurant, I felt like this is actually my calling. I was enjoying it, I was learning it fast, so dun siya nag-start.
The Biltmore's calendar is always packed, and he recently oversaw the banquet for the two-day Astra Film and TV Awards, where Hollywood stars including the cast of The Color Purple attended.
Anong pinakamalaking challenge sa mga malalaking events na ganito?
Siyempre, pressure. For this event, I think this is the first awards event for the year, especially after the strike and all that. So it's a big responsibility, you know, for me. I'm just really honored to represent the Biltmore Hotel, represent the Filipino community as well. I feel like I have a little touch on something that we do here at Biltmore.
Film and TV shows like the award-winning The Bear showcases the challenges of chefs like him. But Umali says the job may be challenging, but it is also rewarding, especially when he sees his full and satisfied clients enjoying their events. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
Filipino actress Hilda Coronel receives a Lifetime Achievement Award at the 2024 Manila International Film Festival in Hollywood. Steve Angeles has details.
As the first Manila International Film Festival in Los Angeles capped off with an awarding ceremony, all eyes were on veteran Filipino actress Hilda Coronel.
It's fascinating, and I'm very happy for all the Filipinos that make it everywhere in the world, but especially here now that they're here. It's really thrilling.
Coronel was honored with the Manila International Film Festival's Monty Manibog Lifetime Achievement Award. The award is named after Filipino-American community pioneer Monty Manibog. Manibog, a former Philippines Olympic athlete, was one of the first Phil-Am attorneys to practice law in the United States. In the 1970s, he eventually became a city council member and mayor of Monterey Park, just outside of Los Angeles. Coronel accepted the award in front of some 600 people at the Directors Guild of America, including fellow Philippine celebrities Piola Pascual, Tirso Cruz III, Christopher De Leon, Ding Dong Dantes, as well as Philippines elected officials.
I always think when they give me that I feel old. That's why I told them. I laugh. It's just a joke. Thank you.
Coronel's last project was in 2012 for the Star Cinema film The Mistress, in which she picked up several awards. In recent years, she's been staying in the U.S. away from the spotlight with her late husband, Ralph Moore Jr.
Last but not the least, I'd like to dedicate this to my husband, Ralph Moore Jr., who last year has earned his wings. Thank you so much.
As the 67-year-old walked down the gold carpet reuniting with former co-star Christopher De Leon, she revealed to ABS-CBN News that she has plans to return to the screen.
Madami akong offers, and I have about 7 offers and a TV show series, and so I don't know. I'm sifting through it. I'm reading all the scripts now, but I chose one already, and we're in negotiation, so we'll see how it goes.
As for now, Coronel can't give specific details about her potential projects, but no matter what it is, it's expected to add to her already impressive legacy. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Hollywood.
A group of Filipino-Canadian filmmakers and talents have banded together to create a short comedy film about three sisters who accidentally ruin their brother's nuptials. Luena Papasin has more.
Take yours up. Quiet all around.
Three Ates and a Wedding is the first film project that brings together many Filipino creatives, both in front and behind the camera.
Awkwardly stand up.
Filipino-Chinese-Canadian filmmaker Kevin Ang, whose award-winning films have been screened in prestigious festivals including Palm Springs and Cinemalaya, penned and directed the film. Ang said he wanted this to be a project that will harness the talent and expertise of Filipino filmmakers in Vancouver.
We got all these different producers, all these great actors, you know, put them into key roles and just make this big kind of like a family reunion of sorts, both behind and in front of the screen.
The short comedy shows what happens when three sisters, jealous of their mother's love for their youngest brother, embarrass him in their drunken toast at his wedding. Ang got the idea while he was shooting wedding videos a few years back. One of the film's executive producers, Lumen Beltran, is also cast as the second sister, Marisa. Beltran says the comedy highlights how Filipino kids born in Canada are shaped by their upbringing and environment.
We're taught hard work, we're taught love within the family and putting our family members first. But there are some moments, especially as we're getting into adulthood, where we want to embrace our independence.
Larissa Tronco and May Belen, who played the role of the two other sisters, said the film shows that despite misunderstandings within the family, the Filipinas' family bond remains strong.
I think family is the main thing. I think the importance of family, even though you might go through some hard times, at the end of the day, my mom always said blood is thicker than water.
Maybe we may have some small vendettas against each other here and there, but they're all very superficial. And honestly, what really matters is that we can all come together and be happy.
After learning about the Three Ates movie, seasoned Filipino-Canadian thespians made sure that they will have a part in the comedy.
It's a Filipino project, so kailangan suportahan natin yung mga kagaya nating Filipino.
Inoffer yung role sa akin, nakita ko yung cast. Aba, kailangan kasali ako rito. Pinoy eh.
Sigrid Pareja, who plays the mom, said Filipinos are naturally comedians.
I find that yun yung ating coping mechanism to kind of like relax and have fun. It's like we're very fun-loving people. Yeah.
One of the actors in the comedy, Christian Canilanza, was able to get some financial help from the Bank of Montreal for the old Filipino production. Filmmaker Phil Planta, who's also an executive producer in Three Ates, believes this is the right time to make Filipino-made movies that will create buzz in the movie industry.
Hopefully we can all get together and start making bigger projects, pitching projects to the Canadian funding groups and get these projects rolling just like any other filmmaker, but tell our own Filipino stories with our own Filipino cast.
Other Filipino groups also contributed in cash and in kind to ensure the successful production of Three Ates. Ruena Papasin, ABS-CBN News, New Westminster.
A Filipino photographer tells the stories of Filipino expatriates to a documentary photography. The acclaimed artist, who's also a former migrant worker, shares how telling stories of Filipinos overseas gives hope. Don Tagala has this story.
Acclaimed photographer Saiza Bacani was commissioned a documentary photography of overseas Filipino workers in the United Arab Emirates in 2015. She recently talked about her work at the New York University and gave the audience a rare glimpse of the lives that represent the 700,000 Filipino diaspora in the Gulf state.
One of Zaiza's great gifts is she humanizes our kababayans in those situations. And I just learned a lot from her about that. To really hear their stories and listen to them and know what they're going through, both the bad but also the good that they go through, is something that I think we should listen to.
Bacani shares she relates to OFW's experiences having been the child of a migrant worker.
I am one of them, and I do feel that having those experiences give me a very unique perspective on the issues that we go through as Filipino migrant workers.
She also says it is important to tell the story of Filipinos overseas as a way to give hope. Her documentary photography called Comunidad, Filipinos in the UAE, further shows that Filipinos overseas are part of smaller communities in the diaspora, as well as a bigger global community of some 10 million Filipinos abroad.
We Filipinos find each other no matter where we are. I think that's one of the beauty of being Filipino is we recognize our own, we help our own as much as we can, and we share what we have to our fellows.
This sense of community will even be in full display on episode 5 of the Prime Video series Expats, starring Nicole Kidman, which also features Filipino actors Ruby Ruiz and Amelin Pardinile. Bakani is a former migrant worker in Hong Kong, and having lived the life of the characters that these Filipino actresses portray in Expats, she says an important aspect of being an OFW is family separation, highlighted in the limited series that is shining a spotlight on migrant Filipino workers.
Nagkakaroon ng ano eh, ng trauma, the traumas that we carry towards our adulthood. Meron yan, lalabas at lalabas, the trauma of abandonment, the trauma of relationships. I think that is one thing that we should talk about.
For Bakani, capturing the lives of Filipinos overseas, whether through her lens or the lens of Hollywood, and more than humanizing them, it is important to listen with intention to what these migrant Filipinos have to say, so their stories can be told in a more nuanced and dignified way. A special extended episode 5 of Expats that surrounds OFWs in Hong Kong will drop next week, February 15, on Prime Video. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
Filipino actress Liza Soberano makes her Hollywood debut in the romantic horror comedy Lisa Frankenstein. A resident movie critic, Manny the Movie Guy, tells us what he thinks.
To him. I wish I was with you.
Catherine Newton stars in the title role as Lisa, a goth-like high school outcast who's in love with a corpse born 1837. Then one evening, Lisa is smitten, cold surprises the creature is perplexed, and you'll be as confused as the corpse in this derivative film written by Diablo Cody, who won an Oscar for writing Juno.
I can't believe you're here.
Director Zelda Williams, Robin Williams' daughter, makes her feature film debut, and her uneasiness as a first-time director shows. She could not find the perfect tone to blend the macabre and the romantic comedy aspects of the script.
Did you smash the mirror in the bathroom?
And it's too bad because she has a great cast, especially Carla Gugino as Lisa's stepmother and Liza Soberano, arcapamilya, making her Hollywood debut. She stars as Taffy, Lisa's popular stepsister, and the screen lights up every time she's on. She understood the assignment.
Lisa.
Lisa Frankenstein takes the best parts from other films, the candy-colored campiness of the John Waters movies, the tortured soul of Edward Scissorhands, and the central theme of Heathers. Throw in a little natural-born killers and mix it with today's sensibilities, and you'll get a film that truly doesn't know what it is.
Idea.
It's a good thing the movie has a short runtime and the supporting cast is game. It's a bit violent, but for all its blood, it lacks passion and soul. But if you love those teenage angst movies masquerading as goth thrillers, then by all means, watch Lisa Frankenstein. But please, do stay for Liza Soberano, a knockout in her breakthrough role. And for that, Lisa Frankenstein gets 2.5 out of 4 stitched together kisses. And getting a major re-release is Disney Pixar's Turning Red. Originally planned for a worldwide theatrical release, the film went straight to the Disney Plus streaming service in March of 2022 due to the pandemic. It even received a nomination for Best Animated Feature at the 95th Academy Awards.
Oh, about that hustle, am I right?
I enjoyed this heartwarming tale about growing up, and you can fall in love with a funny and sweet Turning Red on the big screen all over again. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
I'm a gross red monster!
China's rich culture put in the spotlight as Beijing rings in the Lunar New Year. State-owned China Media Group hosted the 2024 Spring Festival Gala Friday night, featuring hours of colorful cultural performances. Among those presented in the marathon variety show are traditional Chinese cuisines, beautifully choreographed dances, and a mix of vibrant modern acts. The show reached its peak when the New Year bell rang at midnight, signaling the arrival of the Year of the Dragon. The gala, recognized by the Guinness World Records as the world's most watched annual TV program, is seen as a major cultural symbol for Spring Festival celebrations in China. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. urges Filipinos to rekindle their enthusiasm and optimism as the country welcomes the Lunar New Year. In his Chinese New Year message, Marcos encouraged Filipinos to reflect on their accomplishments in the past year and let these victories spark renewed enthusiasm and optimism. The president also underscored the importance of firm commitment to turn dreams into reality. At Saturday midnight, people flocked to MacArthur Bridge to watch fireworks and celebrate the New Year in Binondo, Manila. Marcos earlier declared February 9 and 10 as holidays as part of the Chinese New Year celebrations this year. In Brazil, a dengue health emergency has not deterred people from carnival festivities in Rio de Janeiro. Hundreds of revelers took to the streets to celebrate the start of the annual street party Carmelitas. This marks the beginning of the carnival. Partygoers dressed up in skin-bearing costumes, despite warnings from authorities to cover up. Now, Brazil's health ministry has recorded over 300,000 cases of dengue infection and 40 confirmed deaths. The December to February southern summer months bring hot and humid conditions, which are ideal for mosquitoes to breed.